Hello everyone. Our topic for discussion is fixed orthodontic appliances. So, with the definition of the fixed orthodontic appliances, these are the devices or equipment that are attached to the teeth which cannot be removed by the patient and are capable of causing tooth movement. Okay. So, the indications for fixed orthodontic appliances are: when precise tooth movements are required, fixed orthodontic appliances are used. These are used for correction of mild to moderate skeletal discrepancies in some of the cases. This can be used to carry out movements like intrusion or extrusion of the teeth. They can be used for correction of rotation. These are indicated when multiple tooth movements are required in one arch. Okay. So let's see the components of fixed orthodontic appliances. Fixed orthodontic appliances consists of some active and passive components. Active components includes separators, arch wires, elastics, springs, whereas passive components are brackets, molar tubes, bands, and other accessories. So we'll see each of the components one by one in detail. So these are the different components. Here you can see the separators. Separators can be either elastic separators or a metal separator known as Kesselring separators. These are the metal separators mostly made up of brass wires. Arch wires, these are the active components. Arch wires are made up of different materials such as stainless steel, copper nitride, beta titanium. They are available in different cross sections also. They can be rectangular, square, or round wires. Multi axle wires are also available. Here in this diagram, you can see the different components. These are the bands placed on the molars. These are the elastics. These are also the active components. These are the brackets, arch wires, elastic modules. Okay, these are some accessories of the orthodontic appliances. These are the lock pins. These are used with the Beck's appliance technique. These are the metal ligature wires. These are the elastomeric or the orthodontic ligatures, or also known as the elastic modules. These are used to ligate the arch wire with the slot of the brackets. Okay, springs. Springs can be of many types: open coil spring,
separator.
closed
These are
coil
used
spring,
to
sharp
create
pin
the
springs,
space.
okay, in between the tight proximal contacts before the bending the teeth. Okay, while going for bending the teeth, we need to create a space so that we can pass on the band strip. So we need to create a space, and that's why the separators are used. So the principle behind the separators is the wedging principle. They are placed like a wedge. Here you can see a separator is placed, stretched, and passed on through the proximal contact of the teeth. Here you can see, and they are left in the place for 20 to 24 hours, and they create a space. Okay. Next are the arch wires. These are also the active components of the fixed orthodontic appliances. There are certain ideal properties for the arch wires. The arch wire should have high spring back. Okay, spring back is the measure of how far a wire can be deflected without causing permanent deformation. So ideally the arch wire should have a high spring back. Okay, next property is stiffness. An arch wire should have a low stiffness, because a higher stiffness arch wire will produce heavy forces which are not desirable in fixed orthodontic treatment. So we need a wire which is lower stiff, or which produces low stiffness, so that it applies a relatively light forces over a light constant force over a longer duration of time. The next property is formability. Higher formability is desirable for an arch wire so that the wire can be bended in many forms. Wire should have a high resilience, so Basically, the resilience is the amount of force the wire can withstand without permanent deformation. So if the wire has high resilience, it can easily bear the forces applied without undergoing any permanent deformation. The wire should also be biocompatible, okay, and wire should also have the property of joinability and weldability. Okay, these are the different materials of which the arch wires are made. They can be stainless steels, niti, copper niti, TMA. TMA is titanium molybdenum alloy. Wires can also be coated with ceramic or composite. As basically, the aesthetic wires are made up of ceramic or composite. Next components are bands. These are the thin strips of stainless steel which are adapted to the contours of teeth, to which the attachments can be welded or soldered. Here you can see a band and a molar tube onto which is welded. They can be attached to molars, premolars, incisors or canines depending upon the situation. Okay, there are bands can be of two types. They can be custom made or preformed. Custom made are nothing but a thin, basically a thin strip of metal which are contoured around the molar or premolar, and then they are cemented. Okay, preformed bands are the available bands with different sizes. They are ready to be banded or cemented. They are just checked for the size and placed on the teeth and later on cemented. Okay, next component is springs. These are the active components. They can be made up of nickel, titanium or stainless steel. Two basic type of springs are open coil springs and closed coil springs. Here you can see in the picture, this one is an open coil spring which has been compressed between the two teeth to open up the space or create a space. Okay, this one is the closed coil spring. This is used to close the extraction space or interdental space. Okay, this spring is stretched between two points. This is a implant, micro implant, any implant, and this is the hook. So the spring has been stretched between the hook and the implant to close the space. So let's move to the next components are elastics and elastomerics. These are again the active components. This includes intraoral elastics, elastic or E-chains, elastic modules or also known as elastomeric ligatures or elastic rings or also known as O-rings. Next are elastic threads. So let's see them one by one. First are intraoral elastics. These are the natural or synthetic rubber. They can be used for various purposes depending upon the situation. They can be used for class 2 correction, class 3 correction, cross bite correction, open bite correction and midline correction. For class 2 correction, they are placed on the lower molar till the upper canine. For class 3 correction, they are placed from upper molar to lower canine or lower hook. For correction of cross bites, cross elastics are placed from the palatal surface to the buccal surface of the teeth in opposing arch. Box elastics are used for the closure of open bite. They are placed in a shape of box extending from the upper canine to lower canine. Okay, on both the sides. Midline elastics are used to correct the midline discrepancy. They are placed on canine on upper arch till to the canine on lower arch of the opposite side. Okay. Next are elastics or E-chains. These are used for closing the space. They are available in various configurations such as long, short or closed. Depending upon the interdental spaces, this type of E-chains can be selected. Any one of the E-chain can be selected. Next are the elastic modules. These are used for securing the arch wire with the bracket slots. They are available in various colors. Transparent Elastic modules are also available. Next are elastic threads. They are also used for closing the space, or they can also be used for tying the different attachments with the arch wires. Okay, so let's move to the next. These are molar tubes. These are the passive components of the fixed orthodontic appliances. They are available in different configurations. They can be either with single slot, triple slot, or double slot. In triple slot, this one is the main arch wire slot. This is an accessory arch wire slot, and this is the head gear tube slot. Okay, when you are using a head gear in association with the fixed orthodontic appliances, the wire bow, it passes through the head gear tube. Okay, so let's move on. The next component are the brackets. These are the passive components which acts as handles attached to the tooth surface, and the forces from the arch wires are transmitted through the brackets to the teeth. Okay, so they act as a handle. They just transfer the force from the arch wire to the tooth surface. Brackets can be classified in several ways, based on the techniques, based on the slot design, based on materials, based on method of ligation, based on mode of attachment. So based on technique, they can be classified as edgewise brackets, ribbon arch brackets, tip edge brackets, and recently there are many more types of techniques. So these are the basic techniques only. Okay, so let's not go in that depth. So based on slot design, they can be horizontal slot bracket, vertical slot bracket. Based on the materials, they can be metallic brackets, ceramic brackets, plastic brackets, glass brackets are also available. Based on the method of ligation, they can be self-ligating brackets or non-self-ligating brackets. Based on the mode of attachments, they can be weldable or bondable. Here you can see in the picture, these are the edgewise brackets. These are the ribbon arch brackets. Okay. Here you can see the ceramic brackets, metal brackets. These are the tip edge brackets. Here the slot design is different from the edgewise. Okay. Here you can see the non-self-ligating conventional type of metal brackets, and these are the self-ligating brackets. Here you can see there is no need of elastic module or ligature wire to secure the arch wire with the slot of brackets. Here there is a clip like thing which secures the arch wire with the bracket slot. It is inbuilt in the bracket design. Okay, these are the brackets, weldable brackets. These are the bondable brackets. For weldable brackets, you need to place a band and then the bracket is welded on the band. Okay, then let's move on. So the placement and removal of fixed orthodontic appliances. It is a stepwise procedure. First step is banding, or the placement of bands on molars. Second is bonding of brackets, which can be either done by direct bonding or indirect bonding. Third step is appliance removal or debonding. Let's see them one by one. Banding. There are three basic steps in banding. That is separation or creation of space for positioning the band. Second is fitting the band of appropriate size. And after the band is fitted, the contour is adapted. Then the final step is cementation, which can be done either by GIC or some light cure resin. Okay. The next step is bracket bonding. Bracket bonding can be done either by direct bonding or indirect bonding. There are several steps for direct bonding. First step is cleaning the surface. The labial surface of the teeth is prepared or cleaned with pumice slurry solution. Okay. After cleaning and moisture control, the next step is acid etching. 37% phosphoric acid is used for 15 to 30 seconds for etching the tooth surface. After etching, 20 to 25 microns of the enamel is removed. Okay. And the next step is applying the primer and curing the primer. And once the priming is done, you can take the bonding agent, squeeze out, and put it on the mesh of the back of the bracket. Okay, and then the bracket is pressed to place on the tooth surface. Once the bracket on the labial surface, the excess of the bonding material it is removed from the corners, okay, from the surroundings. And once the positioning is checked, the bracket is cured with a light curing system, okay. And this is the final step, the bracket is in the bonded place, okay. While in indirect bonding, the brackets are placed precisely on the cast and then held in place with a fitted resin. Fitted resin is basically a soluble resin which is used to place the or hold the bracket on the cast. So after the brackets are placed on cast, a transfer tray is formed on the working cast. The transfer tray can either be formed from a thermoforming sheet using a BioStar machine, or it can be made with a silicon body, heavy body putty material. Okay. Once the trays are formed, the trays are then removed by soaking the cast in warm water. So the fitted resin solution is dissolved in warm water and the tray is easily removed. Intraorally, the teeth are isolated, etched, and chemically prepared. Okay, and then the tray is placed upon the teeth and it is cured. And once the curing has been taken place, the tray is slowly removed, leaving the brackets bonded on the teeth. The final step of the fixed orthodontic treatment, or the last step, is debonding. Steps in debonding is bracket removal and then the removal of residual composite. Bracket removal can be done by many specific debonding pliers, such as lift off instruments or cutting instruments. Debonding pliers are used, and for debonding, a squeezing force is applied at the interface of the bracket base and the tooth surface. Okay. And the final step is removal of the residual composite. Tungsten carbide burrs are used for removal of the composite, and white stone burrs are also used for finishing at the later stage. So till now we have seen the different components of the fixed orthodontic appliance and the different steps in placing and removal of the fixed orthodontic appliances. Now we'll see the evolution or development of the fixed orthodontic appliances. We'll see a part of history till the contemporary fixed orthodontic appliances. So the history of fixed orthodontic appliances starts most importantly from the E-arch, which was given by Engels. Later it was developed into a pin tube appliance, which was later modified by Engels only to a ribbon arch appliance. And a different approach was also given by Engel, which was edgewise appliance, which was far different from the ribbon arch or pin tube appliances. Later, the edgewise appliance was refined and developed into a pre-adjusted edgewise appliance by Lawrence and Andrews, whereas the ribbon arch appliance was modified by Raymond Spigg, and later it was developed into Beck's appliance. And combining the advantages of both pre-adjusted edgewise appliance and Raymond Spigg's appliance, Peter Kessling developed another appliance known as tip edge appliance. Okay. Now we'll see the E-arch expansion or E-arch expansion appliance. It was introduced by Edward Hartley Engel in late 1800s. Okay. In this appliance, basically the bands were placed on molars and an expansion arch was threaded to the buccal aspect of the molar bands. Okay. The bands and brackets were not placed on all the teeth. Only the bands were placed on molars and an expansion arch was joined to all the teeth with the help of an elastic thread. The expansion arch produced a heavy force, and the movements were basically only tipping in lateral direction. So no bodily movement was possible with these appliances. So these were the drawbacks of these appliances. So Engel improvised his appliance and introduced twin tube appliance in 1912. The appliance consisted of vertical tubes which were banded on all teeth. Okay. And the arch wires which carried a soldered vertical pins were inserted in the tubes to carry out the movements. In these appliances also tipping movements were possible, not the bodily movements were possible. Okay. So it was later modified by Engel only in 1925, and it was known as the first appliance to use true bracket having a vertical slot facing occlusally. He modified his own appliances, okay, and it was known to be as the true bracket having a vertical slot facing occlusally. The appliance enabled rotation correction, buccolabial and incisogingival movement, whereas the mesiodistal movements were difficult. So Raymond Bakes, which was a student of Raymond Engel's School of Orthodontics, learned the ribbon arch technique from at the Engel's school, and when he moved back to Australia in 1925, he started to practice ribbon arch appliance and modified it to a better technique and presented it as Beck's appliance. Okay, so the Beck's appliance is nothing but the modification of ribbon arch appliance. Edgewise appliance was the last contribution of Engel's given in the field of orthodontics in 1928. In this system, he devised a use of metal bracket with a rectangular slot of dimension 422 by 428 inch, okay, which received a rectangular wire of same dimension. Here you can see a metal bracket slot system. Here you can see the depth of the bracket, which is 428, and the height of the slot is 422. The depth of the slot is 428 and the height is 422 inch. So the rectangular slot received a rectangular wire of the same dimension, and this technique was known as edgewise technique, and thus the appliance was named as edgewise appliance. Receiving a rectangular wire in a rectangular dimension is edgewise technique, and thus the appliance was named after it as edgewise appliance. So edgewise technique enabled the movement in all three planes of space. Okay, before the edgewise appliance, there was a drawback with all the appliances that the movements in all three space of plane were not possible. Only tipping movements and some amount of rotation correction was possible. Not the movements in all three planes of space was possible. It was made possible only with the edgewise appliance. But the only drawback here with the standard edgewise or the previous edgewise appliance is that it required an arch wire which needed to be ideal for that patient. Okay, and so there were certain requirements for arch wire to be ideal. It needed to have some certain bends. There were three types of bends. First was the first order bends, or also known as inset or offset bends. They were used to compensate for the labiolingual prominences of the teeth. Second were the second order bends or tip back bends. They were used to achieve the correct mesiodistal axial inclination of the teeth. Next were the third order bends or the torque. These were used to get correct buccolingual position by movement of the roots. So here in the diagram you can see the first order bends. This is the occlusal view for labiolingual movement. Okay, for offset or inset, the first order bends were given in the wire. Here in this diagram, this is the frontal view. For mesiodistal inclination, the second order bends were given, and this is the proximal view
okay, or the lateral view. Here the twist in the wire was given to produce the torquing or uprighting of the teeth. Okay. The next appliance is the Beck's appliance. As I told you that Raymond Beck's was trained at the Angle School of Orthodontics. In 1925, he returned back to Australia and started practicing edgewise. And in the meantime, he modified Angle's ribbon arch technique by the means of modifying, he incorporated bends in the wire and used different auxiliaries with the ribbon arch or the previous ribbon arch technique, and thus produced Beck's appliance. So Beck's appliance is just the previous ribbon arch technique along with the incorporated bends and use of different auxiliaries. Okay. And this appliance used the concept of differential force and tipping of the teeth rather than bodily movement. Differential force means different amount of force needed at the different stages of treatment. He utilized light forces and tipping of the teeth movement during the initial stages of treatment. So he used round stainless steel wires, thin stainless steel wires during the initial stages, where at the later stages he used full dimension rectangular wires to control the final tooth movement by providing the bodily movement. Okay. So there are three stages of the Beck's treatment. First stage is alignment, decrowding, rotation correction, anterior space closure, and achieving an edge-to-edge bite. So the end result of the stage one should be the alignment, decrowding, rotation correction, space closure, and achieving an edge-to-edge bite. These were the results which were desired at the end of stage one of Beck's treatment. And at the end of stage two, the remaining extraction space were closed while maintaining the result of stage one. And at the last stage, stage three, uprighting and torquing of the were done to achieve normal axial inclination. Here you can see in the diagram or the picture, these are the pre-treatment. This is the pre-treatment photograph or condition. This is the result at the end of stage two. Okay, at the end of stage two, alignment, decrowding, rotation correction, space closure, extraction space closure, everything has been done. Okay, but there is no uprighting and torquing, or there is no normal axial inclination of the teeth. As you can see, they are retroclined. Okay, so at the end, during the stage three, torquing has been done and normal axial inclination has been achieved. Okay. So the next appliance is straight wire appliance. This is the modern day appliance, one which you see routinely. Okay. These are the recent modification of the edgewise appliance. This was introduced by Lawrence F. Andrews in 1970s. This is based on the Andrews 6 keys of normal occlusion. Andrews has conducted a research on 120 patients, normal patients with normal occlusion, and he came up with the 6 keys for normal occlusion. Basically, these were the criteria for an occlusion to be called as normal. So based on those keys, he devised an appliance. So the basic concept for this appliance was using a programmed bracket. Okay. These brackets were programmed to have the first, second, and third order components so that the wire doesn't need to have a complex wire bending. Hence, plain arch wires can be used. So once the brackets are programmed for adequate first, second, and third order bends or components, the wire doesn't need to be bent. We can use a straight plain arch wire. So that's why the appliance or the technique is termed as pre-adjusted edgewise appliance or straight wire appliance. One of the modern technique or appliance is lingual technique. It was introduced by Craven Kirsch in 1976, and since then there has been so much of evolution in the lingual technique. There are 8 generations of brackets, lingual brackets. Okay, so there has been a lot of evolution in lingual technique. Brackets are placed on the palatal and lingual aspect of teeth. Both edgewise and Beck's principle can be applied for the treatment. So we can use either a rectangular bracket with a rectangular wire as in edgewise appliance, or a bracket with vertical slot and round wire as in Beck's principle. The latest appliance is the tip edge appliance, which combines the advantages of edgewise as well as the Beck's appliance. It allows tipping during the initial stages of treatment when the round wires are used as in Beck's technique, and at later stages it uses a full-size rectangular wire to achieve a better control of final tooth position. As you can see here, this is a tip edge bracket system. We can use a round wire also or rectangular wire also with this bracket system. So this is the advantage of using a tip edge appliance. You can use both type of wires at different stages. So at early stages, tipping movements are allowed, and at later stages, bodily movements can be done. Okay. So that's all about the fixed orthodontic appliances. Thank you for your patient hearing.